Good morning and welcome to Morning Movie News. Now, obviously, Hollywood is on vacation like the rest of the world over the holidays, so not a lot of stories have been breaking. So I thought I'd dedicate today's episode to answering viewer questions. So I've picked four instead of covering the usual three stories and a viewer question. And this is actually something a few of you have been asking me to do on a regular basis, dedicate an entire episode to viewer questions so I can get to more of them. So let me know what you think of the results. All right, so the first question is actually a kind of a combo question from two people who asked about the same topic. The first was on Twitter, actually. Brandon Kelly said, hey, Grace, viewer question. Are you happy with the Disney new CG renaissance, or do you still like the previous hand-drawn era better? And then the similar question comes from Usama Saeed, or Syed, who says, Grace, in your top 10 2013 movies list, I noticed none of the animation movies were chosen. Movies like Despicable Me 2, Monsters University, one of my favorite of the year, says Usama, Frozen, The Croods, Epic, etc. Do you think that Disney and the others should be more concerned about that since they're since their movies are not involved in the top 10 list? And also you'll notice that a lot of critics have not chosen animated films in the top 10 regarding many movie reviewers and fans, as Usama just pointed out. Love your reviews. Thank you, Usama, and a smiley face. I love the smiley face. Okay, so let's talk about animation in general this year. Of course, it made a ton of money. It's like they're drawing it. And so I think that's nice to see, because a lot of us animation fans have been concerned about the future of animation. It looked really touch and go there for a while, and a number of us are still concerned about 2D animation, hand-drawn animation. I like computer animation, but I feel that 2D animation provides a warmth and a connectivity with the audience that's very unique and special, and so I don't want that to go away. I'm glad that they invented the technology that was on display in Paperman. There is this film that Disney looks like they're going to be applying to it to in 2018, so that's pretty far away. So at least the good news here that I'm happy about, and I think a lot of us are happy about who are animation fans, is that the genre is doing well. It's very healthy. Now, the real problem, though, and this is often a problem with Hollywood, and I guess as animation becomes more profitable, it can share in the problems of all movies, and that is, you know, quality of the film over quantity of the box office. And I think that as long as Hollywood is raking in a ton of money off of these films, you're not going to really see a lot of change in terms of quality, because they're like, nah, it doesn't matter. I mean, audiences are going. So it's what I always say about that, unless you really love the film, don't go more than once, because of course we're not going to miss the film, especially if we're a fan of animation, we want to see it in theaters, but you know, when you give a lot of money, Hollywood thinks that gets that very realistically and reasonably as the go-ahead to continue to do what they're doing. Now, while I didn't like Frozen, a lot of people did. Frozen really, I think, I don't know if it's so much of the film itself, but I think the kind of film that it is, a princess musical with really beautiful animation, has really touched a nerve with animation fans. And I think that's where you're seeing a lot of love coming in for the film. And I think you're also seeing a lot of forgiveness for its flaws. The biggest thing people said in response to my criticisms of the film was, hey, you're taking this too seriously. It's just Disney animated films for kids. So why do you, you know, who cares if it's not perfect or not really great storytelling? And I would counter that a lot of, for decades, the Disney films in particular, were very good and could match and stand toe-to-toe, shoulder-to-shoulder with live-action films in terms of quality. And I think that the excuse, well, it's for kids, let's just write off doing a good job, or excuse it, is a slippery slope. And just because it worked out okay here for a lot of people, if you give Disney that allowance, imagine what you might be seeing down the line. I think that story is always king for any age group. And just think about the things that you remember most when you were a kid. You know, what stuck with you? The best books. And so I worry about giving Disney a pass just because we, you know, kind of liked what we saw. So I think that the CG renaissance is necessary to give Disney animation a backbone to build up its self-confidence. You can make a successful movie. It's not just Pixar. But I feel Pixar has also slipped a little bit, and they're also tempted by money. They're making all these sequels because they make money, but you're not seeing anything, I think, on par with the original films they used to create. Now, of course, there's the rumor that Pixar is just simply out of ideas. There's that napkin story where they wrote down a bunch of ideas when they started up on a napkin, and they finished the napkin, and there's nothing left. And a lot of their great creators also have moved to live action. Brad Bird, for instance, and Andrew Stanton wanted to go there, but he failed with John Carter, and he's back for the Finding Dory, the Finding Nemo sequel. So I think that, you know, Pixar did very well because of story, and I think if you aren't willing to give Pixar a pass, you shouldn't give Disney Animation a pass. They should be held to the same standards because they used to be the leader in the field. So I am concerned, but I'm no more concerned about animation's quality as I am just movies in general's quality. You know, I just want to see good stories being told no matter what the genre or medium. So, but at least, you know, it's making a lot of money and we're not going to see it go anywhere. I'm very excited for How to Train Your Dragon. I hope that it's as good as I want it to be, and I hope it's a potential game changer for animation. That and Big Hero 6. 2014 could be a very big year for animation. So we'll see what happens. So that's my answer to the first question of the day. The second comes from Sawyer Griffin. Sawyer Griffin says, hi, long time watcher. Hi, Sawyer. Thank you. First time questioner, or whatever you call it. That's great. Questioner's good. I love people who ask questions for the first time. I love that everybody asking questions is inspiring more people to jump in. So Sawyer says, I was not very impressed with The Amazing Spider-Man. I was wondering what your thoughts were on the franchise branching out into the Ultimate Universe, and that it might go towards a more Miles Morales path. I'm rooting for this. I think this would be great. However, I kind of like Andrew Garfield in the role. I know that a lot of Spider-Man fans do not like him because they've kind of gone away from the nerdier, you know, more, you know, good guy qualities that Peter Parker's been so famous for decades, and gone with a more modern emo, you know, grunge kind of approach for the character. But I think Andrew Garfield does a very nice job. He looks like he has even more jokes in the second film, the sequel. I think he's going to grow into the role even more. So I'm happy with him. However, as they want to expand the universe, so why not bring Miles Morales on board? And I'm really impressed with the interest in Miles Morales from you guys in the comment section. In general, remember when Donald Glover came out and said, why can't I play Spider-Man? And a lot of people said, yeah, why can't he? And I think that Miles Morales was an answer in somewhat to that question that Marvel very admirably did, and did well. I think Miles Morales is not a token character. He is very rich. He's a very rich character with a great background, a lot of his own very distinct problems. He's not just, hey, look, it's a black Spider-Man, which I think comics are often accused of doing, or it's a female Spider-Man, you know, the way they always just kind of appease different demographics by just sticking a very popular character's brand on that kind of demographic. But I think Miles Morales is a legitimate character, very well realized, and I think Hollywood could be surprised with how successful he could be on the big screen. So I hope that Sony does roll the dice and try this out, because I think that sooner or later, some comic book cinematic universe is going to have to put a minority or a female character, or both, why can't we just get one movie for each, in a lead role? Because, you know, maybe, I don't know, there's a lot of male characters they can go to, so maybe they won't. But someone is going to get desperate enough and roll the dice, and I think be really rewarded for it, for being first out of the gate. And just look at the success of Fast and Furious, a very diverse franchise. And I don't understand why Hollywood doesn't see that and get the lesson and understand what's happening. You know, dollar is king in Hollywood, that's what makes the rules, and they're seeing that this money can be made from this. So I really think a Miles Morales Spider-Man could be quite successful, and so I hope Sony realizes that. I also think a Black Panther movie could do very well, and I don't see why Marvel isn't focusing on that. Or, as my vote goes, a Jon Stewart Green Lantern. That's really what I want to see. There was a great mock-up of Idris Elba in the role. Of course, we'll never get it because he's in the Thor films, but I think that could also be a really great character. All right, so that's the second question of the day. The third question of the day is from Jack What Up 7. And Jack says, hey Grace, hope you're having a happy holiday. I am, Jack, thank you. I have a question about JJ Abrams. I watch shows like Revolution and Almost Human. I watch Almost Human too. So good. Shows that JJ executive produces. And I'm wondering how he is able to jump from movies to TV work so easily and not have the fact that he works on TV damage his reputation when he does a movie. As you've said, I'm saying that bouncing back and forth between television and movies can hurt someone's career. And why does he find success as others have failed? Thanks in advance for answering the question. Thank you, Jack What Up 7. Very good question. And I think that especially in light of my often commenting that jumping back and forth between movies and TV can be harmful, it's worth discussing because it might seem like there's a discrepancy there, but the truth is they're very different situations. What I'm always talking about is actors. It's very hard for actors to jump back and forth. Although when you talk about Almost Human, I think that's a really great opportunity for both Michael Ealy and Carl Urban, who aren't doing so well on the big screen. So they actually become, you know, big fish in a little pond when they go to the small screen. So that's a smart career move, I think, for both of them. And they're both very good on that show. I love Almost Human so much. And I know a few of you have also been asking me what I think of it, and I think a number of you are enjoying it as well. I've mentioned The Met and The Blacklist are my two favorite shows right now on network television. And they're making me feel a little better about network television in general. But anyway, back to your question, Jack, what up, Seven? So that, you know, actors, it's difficult because, you know, audiences often feel, well, you know, I can see the actor on TV for free. Why should I pay to see them in a movie? And it just also makes the movie seem a little smaller, not as big a deal. So once again, you know, when you have to make those crucial decisions about what to spend your money on, which is particularly important today with today's economy, a lot of people don't have big movie budgets. They're going to select the bigger special effects or the actors they can only see on the big screen, and therefore they feel maybe more worth the trip and the expense. But it's very different when it comes to producers, and that's what JJ Abrams is doing. He might direct an episode here and there, you know, a pilot such as Joss Whedon did for Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., but what these people are doing, even these directors in film, they're working as producers. Now, other filmmakers who are quite successful on television are Bryan Singer. He produced House, was his. And also, of course, Jerry Bruckheimer is an incredibly successful television producer with a number of network shows. The CSI shows are his, and he's very successful in both film and television. So that's the difference. You're seeing it's just a producing effort. And basically, JJ doesn't actively produce these shows. He oversees them. They're coming from his production company, Bad Robot, in JJ Abrams' case. So that's why it doesn't hurt him, because it's, you know, it's a business behind the scenes decision. His face isn't going there. And so it allows him to still have that cachet. And so also when he directs a movie, that's still very special because he's not really directing TV anymore. Of course, that's where he started, just like Joss Whedon started there. But you'll notice that they both moved over into film. If they continued to direct television, I think that they would have a problem. That would also hurt their careers. Just like Alan Taylor directed Game of Thrones and such on HBO and then jumped to Thor. And now it looks like he's going to be doing the new Terminator. So he's not going back to television either. Usually when you make that jump as talent, you want to stay with your new medium. But when you're a producer, you're not, you know, that's not, the talent doesn't, that doesn't fall under the talent umbrella. When you're a producer, you can jump back and forth because, you know, it's all just projects that you're overseeing, and a producer oversees multiple projects at the same time. All right, so thank you so much. I'm glad I could clear that up. Thank you for asking that question, Jack, what up, Seven? All right, so the final question of the day is from Digital Leonardo. And the questions are very long, so the list goes, my notes get very long here, so sorry about the eyeline. But Digital Leonardo asks, question. I went to a movie on Christmas. Thanks for recommending Saving Mr. Banks. It was fantastic. I'm so glad you liked it, Digital Leonardo. I love that movie. I think it's so good. I want to see it again, but as I've been saying, it has horrible distribution, and I can't find a theater to go see it in. But it says, and it's been a while since I've been to a theater, and I was really annoyed that we had to sit through 15 minutes of advertising before the trailers even started. If movie theaters are getting all this extra income from piling on commercials, why do they still cry foul that they make no money? Shouldn't this extra income allow for cheaper movie prices or at least cheaper popcorn? I just feel at the end of the day, it's the consumer who is being screwed over and the main reason I wait for movies on demand. Boy, Digital Leonardo, all I can say is you got off easy. I went to the movies yesterday and I had to, I saw Lone Survivor, which I'll be reviewing next week. And I had to sit through not only commercials, all the pre-show stuff, but I had to sit through half an hour, usually 20 to 25 minutes of trailers. And not only that, but AMC Theaters has added these new really long, like, audience, like, interstitials at the beginning that they're like, you know, for saying, hey, look for the exits, turn off your cell phone. But instead of just taking, like, about 5 seconds to say that, they have these new little stories and jokes they like to tell. And I think their heart might be coming from the right place, trying to offer more entertainment. But, you know, I had gotten myself a hot dog as a movie theater snack, and it got cold by the time the movie started. So I've actually stopped buying snacks in general, and I forgot about it this time because it was a holiday and I wanted to treat myself. But I should have just really, you know, not bothered, because I forgot that it's so frustrating that I usually finish my snacks before the movie starts. So I've actually stopped getting them. I just get a beverage. But I think that I totally agree. And actually, while I was sitting there, I said, you know, I so appreciate it when I go to these press screenings that the movie just starts. And I'm kind of at that point because we see all these trailers online. You know, how often is it you see a trailer for the first time in theaters these days? What's the point even so much of showing them on the big screen? I mean, there are some trailers I would like to see on the big screen. They showed the RoboCop trailer. I could, the second one, not that crappy first one, but the second one, I could almost watch down an endless loop. But at the same time, with Lone Survivor, for instance, they showed that trailer so many times recently that, you know, when it would come on, I'd be like, I've seen this so many times. But I've had a very interesting reaction to the movie. I'm looking forward to reviewing it and sharing my thoughts on it. But anyway, back to your question, Digital Leonardo, I totally agree. I think that it's just become such a chore with the movie situation, not only in terms of people being disruptive, as they were at the screening, by the way, it was so frustrating, but also then the theater not only policing the audience, but, you know, really being greedy with the pre-show and how long they're making it. And it really is, you know, it's like, it's a hassle to go to the movies instead of the joy that it should be. But I'm glad that the movie, once it finally started, you liked it and you enjoyed it. And I hope that there's a theater that starts coming along that I would pay a few dollars more for it to make sure it was clean. They showed less trailers or no trailers, and they policed the audience. I mean, I wouldn't pay the $33 super ticket price they're trying to float out there, but I would pay $2 to $3 more a ticket to guarantee that kind of experience. I mean, it's a sad reality. But I wish that our common moviegoer, the common man, had more decency and was more sensitive to the people around them trying to go to the movies. But I guess that's not the world we live in anymore. So I will pay the extra money to create a fake version of just fooling myself into thinking everyone's polite for 2.5 hours to 3 hours. So I'm sorry that you had that experience, but I totally agree with you. So that's today's Morning Movie News. I hope you enjoyed this viewer question episode dedicated all to your questions. I was able to answer 4. Write down below what questions you'd like answered on Monday and any potential stories you think that I might have missed that are breaking right now to discuss then. Thanks for watching.